So we're continuing. So next we have two great guys. Gab is a Filipino conservation photographer and environmental storyteller. Also, he's an international award-winning photographer and a National Geographic Explorer covering stories on nature, the climate crisis, and also people. And on the other hand, Andrew is a National Geographic Explorer and Education Fellow supporting youth-led movements and organizations around the globe. As a junior in high school, he co-founded the Kentucky Students' Voice Team, which helps to amplify and elevate students as partners in improving Kentucky schools. This session is about storytelling for impact. Because we believe that every community has a story. So this stage is yours, guys.
Hello, hello. Can you all hear me? Can you hear me, Aria?
Yes.
Thank you so much for having us this morning. This is my second year participating in Youth-A-Thon, and so I'm really excited that the tradition continues. I'm going to just say a few things up front and introduce Gab, and then pass it over to Gab for a short presentation about his work and some of his experiences. And then we can have a little bit of a back and forth and question and answers as well. So if anyone is watching and wants to ask some questions in the chat along the way, please feel free. I have plenty of questions though, so we will have a question and answer period either way. So yeah, I'll just get right into it then. I know that we are coming, I guess, I don't even know what hour this is for you all. I guess more than 12 hours at this point. So thanks for sticking with us. But my name is Andrew, like I said, I'm a National Geographic Education Fellow. Where I work to support young leaders and change makers like everyone on this call all around the globe. At National Geographic, we use the power of science, exploration, education, and storytelling to illuminate and protect the wonder of our world. The future facing us as young people in this world has really never been more uncertain. And as you have noticed, I'm sure, large-scale youth-led mobilization has grown to an unprecedented level all around the globe, with young people calling for action on so many different environmental and social justice issues. At National Geographic, we are focused on how we can support young people foster the movements, organizations, inventions, stories that kind of we're already driving. Right now, we're at a pivotal moment where young people are leading efforts around the world to advance our understanding of our planet and the need to protect it. So today's conversation is really gonna focus in on how young people can use the passion and creativity that we bring to the table to tell compelling stories about our planet that move people to action and that build support for conservation efforts that we know are so critical. And we're going to hear from Mr. Gab Mejia, who you've already introduced just a little bit, but I'll say he is a Filipino conservation photographer and environmental storyteller who covers stories ranging from the climate crisis, indigenous communities, endangered species, and hopefully we can talk about a little bit of each day during today's conversation, as well as what it's like to explore Patagonia, which in addition to being a brand, for those of you that don't know, is also an actual place on Earth. So really looking forward to that. But before I bring Gab on for his presentation, I did just want to share a short video from National Geographic. You know, we have recently put out a resource for young people called the Storytelling for Impact course, This is an online, self-paced, completely free to access storytelling course taught by National Geographic Explorers like Gab. And for any of you watching who maybe get some ideas from this conversation or feel inspired to learn more about storytelling following this conversation, I would urge you to check out this resource. So I'm going to share my screen to share a short video, and then I'll share a link to the course right after, and then hand it right over to Gab. So let's see if I can...
My middle school was probably really awkward. I had no idea what I wanted to do.
I was pretty nerdy, actually.
I was either reading or playing sports. Middle school was not my finest point. I think I never really thought about what storytelling is because you just grow up being told stories about things.
Adventure type stories were things that took me out of where I was living and took me into parts of the world that I had never experienced before.
When I was a kid, I took stories for granted. I never really thought much about the work that went behind it. Later, as I started to study storytelling, I wanted to know more about how stories are told in a way that can make a difference. Now, as a storyteller, I try to look for ways that can use stories to connect people.
It's a way of going out into the world, learning something about the world, but also learning something about oneself in the process.
Now I know that even telling a simple story, whether it's through writing or photos or videos, there's a lot of work that goes behind it and that it's not as easy as it seems.
Storytelling is how we live our lives. It's how we make sense of things.
Storytelling is something that we have experienced as human beings for generation upon generation upon generation.
Storytelling draws you in, then you begin to see it with fresh eyes, and then you go down the rabbit hole from there.
I think it's important, especially when you're taking images, to take images that will make people feel something, because you can take a picture that's like a technically perfect picture, but if it doesn't have that feeling and that connection, then it's not going to have any impact.
Sound is directly hardwired to our heart, to our emotion center.
One of the things I'm trying to do is get people excited about the world and feel awe about the things around them.
One thing that I wish I knew earlier, like when I knew I was going to become a photojournalist, was the importance of language. Learning languages is a really powerful way to connect to people.
To be a great storyteller, students need to be curious. You have to always be asking questions. You can't ever assume that the way you see things is right. I think you always have to listen. As a storyteller, you're really trying to learn from the people around you and the things that you see. So you have to always just keep your eyes open, your ears open, and see what you can learn.
And so with that, I will post a link to the Storytelling for Impact course in the chat for anyone that wants to check it out. But I'd love to now pass it over to Gab to share a little bit more about your work.
Hey, Andrew, thanks so much. It's so nice to see you, even if we're like 12 hours apart. I'll just share my screen. Okay, cool. Could you guys see it? So, yeah, just a short introduction. I guess my name's Gab. I'm from the Philippines. And honestly, like being a storyteller, this would actually be, or what would look like a day in the field of a job as a photographer or a filmmaker. And honestly, when I was young, I was always wanted to become like a National Geographic Explorer to be able to document stories of our planet. And growing up in the Philippines, an archipelago country made out of 7,600 plus islands, I would always be surrounded in these mountain landscapes, you know, the beautiful mountains, the evergreen forests, all the way to volcano summits, and even up into the beautiful reefs that we have. My journey going in becoming a storyteller, I've always asked like this question of what story do you want to tell? And it was sort of, should I share my own story? Would it be a story about my country? Would it be a story about my identity? But later on realizing it wasn't just really about, you know, the subject of the story that you're trying to tell. But really, I changed and reframed that question in what do you want to change with your story? And I think that was one of the most pivotal moments in my life in becoming a storyteller, in realizing that really, you know, stories have the power to actually change not just yourself and exploring yourself and being curious about the world around you, but because it leads to this, you know, greater things of impact, giving solutions, empowering communities and locals, that I found so much more important than just being able to relay out information or just, you know, to share awareness about something, but truly the impact that involves in the stories that you tell. You know, because like in truth, photography, the aids of visual storytelling is one of the most universal languages that we have. Like a lot of us are culturally diverse in the Philippines as well. And of course, around the world where we speak different languages, we speak different dialects. But photography or like the power of visual storytelling is that we could actually resonate and be able to connect with these images without even having to, speak that language. And working back, I said like, okay, maybe I have to think about the impact force of what do I really want to change with the stories that I create. And then through this impact, that's where I think of like maybe the characters, the communities that I work with, the friends that I have, the stories that I believe or the science facts that matter, the advocacies that I believe in. And what makes a great story is also honestly the conflict that's involved, you know, being able to share the issues that we're facing, the injustices and social and environmental injustices that we're facing with the stories that we tell. And that drives through that certain narrative of how do you go about it? What are the solutions being made? What are the traditions, the cultures, the exciting and awe-inspiring features that you want to share about the places that you visit? And I always think of like the visuals being one of the last, you know, priority in being able to tell a good story. It doesn't matter if you take, you know, nowadays we have our phones, we have our gadgets to able to take beautiful photos, even without like expensive cameras and gears. But how much of these stories or photos or visuals can actually relate to someone else, or how much could it actually inspire to someone else? And working backwards, I realized that impact should be the centerfold of the stories that we create. And this is the story that you could share to the platforms of your community, of the country, the different countries that you live in. I remember doing this project with National Geographic for about 2 years as an early career grantee in the Agusan marshland. It's one of my backyard, one of my hometowns in the Philippines, found in the southern region in Mindanao. And it's a fraught area where you have a lot of insurgents, a lot of conflict with environmental defenders, miners, palm oil plantation companies. But it's also a beautiful world, you know, one of the most beautiful landscapes that I've ever seen in my whole life. And it's actually one of my favorite places in the Philippines, which I hope you guys could visit, you know, after this pandemic. But it's where migratory birds come flying in from Russia, from Japan, going to this place in our country, in the Philippines. And what's so beautiful about it is not just about the natural heritage that it has, but the cultural diversity and heritage of the Filipino, or the identity that we share with. Because in this place, in the Agusan marshlands, it is home also to the indigenous community called the Manobo tribe. This is Ate Marites Babanto. Her name is Tess. We call her Ate, which is a local term that we show respect for elders in the language Tagalog. And she is one of the indigenous woman leaders of the tribe that's protecting the marsh, who has lived for centuries in this marsh. And I realize how important this story, because going through like global narratives, global platforms, media publications, there weren't stories about, you know, the local communities that we have in the Philippines, the stories about our own hometown that we being shared, that I felt was so important that they wanted to share themselves. And it's a place of coexistence where, you know, these beautiful floating communities using traditional canoes or barotos in our language Tagalog would float in this mystical landscape full of greens and blues. But the stark reality is, like, documenting in the field is a conflict that we experience, you know, being able to share this, not just this beautiful story, but our reality, the truths that they are facing in the Agusan Marsh. And we witness different fires like these. for some, you know, these fires, the fires that are happening, the droughts, the effects of climate change weren't being told on our national headlines. It wasn't being even told in like global reports of, you know, one of the largest wetlands in the Philippines, one of the most ecologically significant places in our country is burning, where plumes of ash and smoke would engulf the communities, this indigenous tribe that has barely anything to do with climate change, that has barely contributed to the effects or the impacts that they're facing with climate change. And it just also, more than this, it also affects the biodiversity, the birds migrating, the interconnectedness of the different countries in Asia. And what's worse is that the youth, you know, the indigenous youth who are facing the challenges of the changing climate and the intense socio-economic development from pollution, destruction, environmental degradation. And what's sad about it, it's what's unfortunate, is that they're losing the part of their culture that, you know, their parents were able and had the privilege to experience of seeing the pristine wetlands of the Agusan marshlands. And we needed to do something about it that, you know, looking forward and looking back, I mean, looking backward to the story that we created together, collaborating, we just saw the magic in how these beautiful stories of our identity, of our youth, our indigenous youth in our country would actually make more profound meaning. And through the help of National Geographic, we were actually able to publish it for a World Wetlands Day this year, how the world's wetlands are actually slipping away. This vibrant sanctuary underscores the state. And after this project, actually, one of the greater challenges also that we came to face, you know, more than just seeing the beautiful images of the marsh or seeing the conflict, was the threats that were involved in telling these stories. I think that's also the risk that comes, which deters a lot of people in our country to be able to tell stories about the environment or stories that could actually impact their community. I remember, you know, sharing these in social media sites, publish the publications and all this, and I would always get threats from like the palm oil plantation companies who would start messaging me, trolling me, sending emails, and, you know, I'm scared of fear mongering, text messages, and it kind of startled me in a way that, wow, I didn't know that these stories are being hidden for some weird reason, maybe corruption, maybe, you know, impunity in the local communities that we have in our developing country. And I said, okay, maybe we have to actually lay low within these stories. But I realized, I don't think so. Like, you know, actually, the more that I received this, I was more empowered to actually share it more because, you know, it's actually reaching the audiences or the people that you wish to actually target and make sure that they're concerned with the stories that you're telling. And what came out of the story, you know, after 2 years of work, after working with indigenous communities and being able to really bring it out in our country, we were able to partner and collaborate with local international organizations who had the tribe really speak for their needs, get what they really want, and be able to develop a longer term for sustainability, where they had education programs and, you know, lobbying for the government to help them and institutionalize the protection of the marsh from climate change. It's something very new, something very exciting that they're actually finally, you know, taking account to deliver change and actually create laws and policies that would help protect the marsh. And I realized how, okay, this is really truly the power of storytelling, you know, being able to bridge not just the youth, but also the different stakeholders that you have from the government, from international organizations, local organizations, the indigenous community in one space. And this project eventually led in supporting the protection or the creation of the ASEAN National Heritage Park for the Agusan Marshlife Wildlife Sanctuary. And it was one of the most amazing feats for it to actually be recognized as a regional or a heritage park that's valued not just in the Philippines, but as well as the whole world or Southeast Asia and the whole world. We were also able to create, you know, Explorer magazines that was distributed to different kids and students across not just in the US, but also in Europe. And of course, it also reached the indigenous communities, the books. And she, this is again, Atetes, one of the indigenous women leaders. And she was just so happy to seeing this project came together after the years of work that she had put, that her story is finally being out there. And this is where I really wanted to push, you know, the power of storytelling, that a lot of people think, you know, taking for granted, because there's photography, for example, or videos would just be something that you would see in social media platforms. And it's something that you kind of try to be disconnected away from. But I realized that you really have to keep making noise if you really want to create impact in the communities that you share with and the communities that, you know, call it your home. And again, going back to this graph that I showed you, or like this figure that I showed you a while ago, how impact should be the center. I think there's also this fine line between how we can separate the aesthetic and the political. And it's often, you know, separate, divided in a way that we should actually integrate in the stories that we create, especially now in a world where there's a lot of injustices happening, not just maybe in the Philippines, but of course in your own countries, from social discrimination or like gender discrimination, whatever kinds of forms of violence or injustices that you're facing. I think there's also that way of being able to really create a story that is powerful, that connects, and that relates to others. I remember also doing this story in during the COVID, the height of COVID in October 2020, when one of the last captive bred tamaraws in our wild, which is a national land mammal for a critically endangered wild buffalo, dwarf buffalo, that's only found in one single island in the Philippines across the whole world. And there's only about 500 of them in the left in the wild, but one of the last captive bred ones for the future breeding program died due to, you know, old age, and as well as the lack of institutional support. And the pandemic really created devastating effects to the whole program, wherein the rangers, the wildlife rangers, the defenders who were protecting this critically endangered species or animal, our national land mammal, were fired or were laid off from their jobs because of the financial restrictions or impacts of COVID-19. But people needed to hear about this story as well. And we went there in October and we told it on CNN. When we showed the power and connection, this is Dr. Angelo Migueras, one of the veterinarians, the wildlife specialists and veterinarians who have been taking care of Tali, who passed away in October. And I guess that relation and connection, how these people who have been struggling even with financial constraints really had that passion for the environment. And we wanted to show this, that even if these people who weren't being given the just institutional support from the government, they were actually connected and so passionate about protecting the animals that we needed to share this more during the pandemic, you know, to give hope and at least to inspire others that, you know, people actually care, and people, local people, are actually care about them, these animals, and that they're protecting. And through this initiative, we partnered with like United Nations Development Program to create a short documentary. So this is Cali, also a photo we took, the black and white one. And we were able to fundraise about $32,000 with United Nations Development Program in securing the livelihoods of the wildlife rangers and environmental defenders here for more than a year. And I think that was really one of the power of collaborating, of like how one story could be a ripple of change and really connect other people with the tamarao, for them to actually drive, you know, concrete actions of, you know, donating or giving funds for the protection or securing the livelihoods of the rangers. And I think if there's any 4 points, I guess, in creating really impactful stories, is that you really want to inform, educate, empower, and of course, inspire others. I think, you know, not a lot of people, it's not that a lot of people don't care about, you know, these issues that we're talking about the environment, about the oceans, about wetlands, about the marshes and the endangered species that we have. It's just some are just, you know, uninformed, or some are just really naive with the issues that they're facing, because there are no storytellers who are telling these stories about these issues in their own localities, which is so important, because I think one of the problems within our generation, maybe speaking for the Philippines, is that people really live in a bubble of just sharing stories in social media or sharing stories. Of course, it is really a powerful tool to create movements and to connect others. But in our place, where a lot of people don't have access to internet, a lot of people may not have access to internet, to digital platforms. There's really this gap that needs to be bridged. And that's the power also of education, of how we can tell these stories, with communities, partnering with schools, and collaborating with education educators. So I think that's really one of the goals as well, of being able to deliver more than just, you know, publishing or the story, but as well bring it really to the forefronts and the localities that you have. And next, of course, is to empower. You know, I think the power of storyteller, like being a storyteller, is already a privilege, I would say, that I have the position to be able to actually take photos or document someone else and have that trust and relationship that I can, that hopefully I would be able to just to give justice to the stories that they share. And I think this really comes in power, the dynamics of being able to empower them for who they are and what they truly represent and what they truly need. And of course, lastly, is to inspire others about, you know, taking action of the advocacies, of the projects, of the stories that you're working on, you know, because there's, all of us have so many amazing stories that we have. We have so many scientists, teachers, educators, conservationists, youth leaders all around our world, all around our countries, all around our communities. And we need to be telling more of these stories as well to inspire others. And it could, it really, really bridges these different gaps that we have. You know, and also I think one of the misconceptions of like being a storyteller, you know, a lot of people think like it's just taking photos or telling stories, but really there's, I would consider it like 10% of the job, but 90% of really is about like researching, editing, workshop, making sure that you really give justice to the story, being able to listen carefully to who you're talking with, this or the subject that you have, and being able to show that it's scientifically proven, or that it's proven by science, given facts, data, because you don't really want to do harm with any subject or any person that you're working with your story. And of course, also involves a lot of heartbreaks, crying, and failing, because you wish that you could actually give more justice or in a way that could actually be more impactful to others. But it really comes along the process of really being a storyteller to the impact. There would be a lot of failures. There would be a lot of trials that you'd be coming in the field, eating nothing but instant noodles in a treehouse, waiting for 5 days to see a crocodile, or even going climbing with ice frozen boots, with your ankles and heels bleeding already, and dealing with leeches and mud. But it's all really part of the fulfillment that comes with being a storyteller, that you really put yourself in a position to take that risk, and for others to really bring that story out there, whatever it could be. And of course, you know, storytelling shouldn't end in Zoom calls. Storytelling shouldn't end in digital forms. We all live in different bubbles, and storytelling should really come on the field, because most of the work is still offline. Maybe not now in the pandemic because of a lot of the different circumstances that we have, but at least it starts there. And this is where we really can bring change with the stories that we create. I always share this photo in the last, also one of the few photos that I last, because this is one of the photos in the Agusan Marsh after seeing the devastating peatland fires because of the droughts from climate change. And it really represents, you know, the two futures that we are heading, and how only a thin line, the juxtaposition of how only a thin line really separates the future that we want and the future that we deserve. Because honestly, you know, being here in this space, I already have the privilege to be able to create choices, be able to, you know, tell these stories. But for others, some won't even have the choice, you know, to choose to deal with the impacts and the effects of, you know, climate change and all the other environmental issues that we're facing. So it's just something that I always want to keep in mind, you know, that there's always be a thin, fragile line between the choices that we make today that would really impact the few different futures that we are all heading. So your voice is your greatest strength. You know, in all this, what matters is that you have the power and the voice, your own voice, to tell your own stories, to tell your community's stories, because this would be the greatest strength that you can have in really bringing change and lobbying to politicians and being able to, you know, really connect with others and tell them that your story matters, that our issues, the environmental issues that we're facing matters, and we need to do something about it. I will show you and you with this short film I think I did when I was, when I did in 19 in Patagonia. And I think this was one of the first few assignments that I really had to create a kind of a visual storytelling. And it was very different because it wasn't really a local place. It was like 10,000 miles away from home, but I needed to create something that would relate to others. So it was a challenge as well, but I needed to put my voices in this story about the changing landscapes or the receding glaciers in Patagonia. So hope that you enjoy this, you know, short 5-minute video.
Imagine if you could fly anywhere in the face of our planet and see it for one last time before it disappears. Where would you fly to make a difference? My journey started in the southernmost city of this world, Patagonia. I felt I was transported to a different world. The days felt like the seasons were changing. The sun would set so late. It was cold and bitter, but not like any other. It was one of the most beautiful landscapes in this planet. But it was dying. Rivers are drying. The trees are wilting. And despite all its beauty, it felt like it was changing, and I was pretty sure it isn't for the better. So here I was, coming from the other side of this planet, journeying to discover the reality of the wetlands and mountains of South America. A 1,000-kilometer journey at the end of the world. Crossing different terrain and meeting unfamiliar creatures along the way. Tracing the waters, climbing the mountains, feeling the wind and cold. Here I was, face to face with massive glaciers. It was my first time to see anything like this. But it was melting, breaking apart, receding faster than ever. But despite this, I knew there was still hope to save this place. We just have to look outside and change.
yeah, so I think that's it for my presentation, Andrew. Thanks so much.
No, thank you for that presentation. I don't know if it's that it's 3:30 a.m. Where I am, or just the video, but I think I'm probably close to tears after watching that. And know that to kind of get the kind of footage that you're able to just show us was probably a really long process. Could you just tell us a little bit more about that trip to Patagonia and kind of what you kind of remember most from some of those experiences?
Yeah, it was actually one of the first assignments that I got after like winning this Global Youth Wetlands Prize for the Ramsar Convention on Wetlands and National Geographic. Mm-hmm. And they basically gave me a list of like the most important wetlands that are dealing with climate change and all this. And I chose like maybe the farthest place I could go out from the Philippines, which is kind of looking back, but I was still like 19 years old that time. And I had to do it for 6 weeks alone. Of course, it was only alone, and I didn't even have like really expensive gear and equipment that time because I was just starting out as a photographer, early career. Right. And I had to find a story. How could I relate the story to my country? And I realized it is really the glaciers that it's impacting, not just the Philippines through typhoons, but also the glaciers, how stark differences there are, but it's like the same environments are being affected. And I think it's really one of the most challenging experiences that I've ever been to. Like, mm-hmm. Looking back, when I was like, yeah, one spray and I could have actually died. Or like, I'm 10,000 miles away from home. I was alone, no parents, no anything. And you know, like, it was a phone call. But I mean, if you're in the wilderness documenting, you won't even have signal. But it took a lot of preparation. I really had to prepare hiking, you know, GPS, all the requirements that I needed to, just to make sure, you know, I wouldn't really put myself in a situation that I would lose my life. But you know,
yeah.
But it was really, I guess, still one of the most profound experiences that I've ever had.
And I mean, there's the physical safety to consider, but then also, I mean, is there an element of mental safety? I mean, does it get lonely being out there for 6 weeks by yourself? I mean, how do you deal with that?
Yeah, I think there was also this, you know, kind of mental fatigue that I was dealing with, especially like after, you know, the third week, fourth week of not hiking nonstop. I was like, oh no, I just want to give up. I can just jump on the glacier and like, mm-hmm. you know, but it was really difficult. I mean, like, I didn't even know if I was going to do a good story. I don't even know what story I really wanted to really create. Like the whole even process of editing, mm-hmm. editing the film, putting it together, the script, or like writing the dialogue that I wanted to share. So I think that really was a mental challenge.
Yeah. No, I was gonna head in that direction next in terms of determining what story to tell. I thought some of the frameworks that you shared in your presentation, including the one that kind of the graphic that put impact at the middle, were really helpful in thinking about the different elements of a story. But when, you know, for many of us, you know, there's so many different things that we want to be making impact on. How do you decide, or I guess prioritize, which impact is going to become the focus of your next project?
Yeah, I always put myself, as I've said, like I've always wanted to put myself in a position where I know the community or where I'm coming from. So I'm maybe sent on an assignment, for example, for like another country, but sometimes I would decline because I realize I'm not the best one to represent that story. So I always make sure that I'm representing a story that I believe in and I have direct connection with it. I'm a local coming from it. So I think it's also progressing in a way. And I always realize that's super important if you really want to relate to others or make sure that your story can relate to others.
And the
Tamarau
buffalo is a good example of that, right?
Yeah, because it happened during the pandemic and, you know, there was no one there to tell the story, and the rangers we had calls with the rangers, and you know, they were struggling. They were asking for loans from restaurants in the city just to get to eat rice or to be able to patrol. And it was so difficult that we needed to really bring in the organizations and community together. And it really made a huge impact because it secured the livelihoods of the rangers for the next years.
Right. And you were able to raise what you said, $32,000.
Yeah.
Wow. And so what lesson did you take away from kind of that experience and being able to kind of have impact in that way that you might kind of keep in mind for moving forward?
Yeah, I've always said, like, if you really want to create change, make sure you start with your backyard. I think that's, yeah. You know, a lot of people think that creating a good story, you have to travel, or be an explorer, you have to travel so far away from your own home or the own problems that you're dealing with. And I think also, you know, this pandemic made me realize how I needed to tell much more of our stories at home, because there's so much injustices that maybe I'm naive as well, and I just needed to share them.
Yep. And that we're all always learning. So I did just want to, like, take a, I guess, a little bit of a step back and just, you know, ask just kind of about how you first became interested in storytelling and photography. You mentioned some of your earlier assignments, but you've been doing this for so long, starting from with such a young age. So what first attracted you to kind of this medium and this way of making impact?
Yeah, I think it really came down to my childhood experience. I was really immersed and educated by dad about nature. He would bring me to local hikes in our local mountains, seeing local wetlands, mangroves, coral reefs in the Philippines. So it was really my identity as a Filipino, that we have so much beautiful places or beautiful natural places. And growing up, I really saw the same places that I was growing up in or visiting with my dad really change. I saw, like, mountains being ripped off all the trees. The corals were turning white because of the coral bleaching. And photography was the tool for me that really became, in a way, to show these impacts happening, the realities that we are happening. And I wanted to gradually document these changes. And so photography really became my medium.
And what is it, do you think, about images and just photography that allows people to connect with stories and with communities that are different from their own or from other sides of the world?
I think it's, one, it's the closest thing you could have of a truth or of a reality, like an image, you know, of the injustice. Like, for example, like the fires that were happening in the Agusan marshlands. Yeah. It is the closest thing that you could have for a reality or a proof to show. And second, it's a medium that doesn't need, like, as I've said again in the presentation a while ago, that it's a universal language. To be able to see a photograph, you don't really need to know how to speak Tagalog, my local language. You don't need to know how to speak English. But once you see a photograph and you realize, you become curious about it, you become attached to, you know, the different subjects or different details that they're in, and you get invested in researching more. That's why, like, a lot of the things in social media, right, we see clickbaity photos, and that's mm-hmm. one way of, like, advertisements. It's the same mm-hmm. way in, like, photography. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That's a really great point. And just, I mean, some of the, I mean, the combination both of the still images and the in the videos that you kind of produce, I think, you know, lead to such an engaging result. And, you know, one of the things that you mentioned as part of your process, I love that graph that you showed, 10% about telling stories, 90% about workshops and mentorship, and then also crying. I would love to hear more about kind of what leads you to feel like crying over the course of the process of telling these stories. Just given, I mean, I know I was going to cry after the Patagonia video, but what is it? What is the impact for you? What is kind of leading to that?
I think one is, you know, the criticisms that you get from your photo editors if they think your image is bad, like you're a failure. Oh no, you have to shoot again. But also, really, I think there are times when I feel like, am I really actually making a change with the stories that I create? I think that's also one factor that goes into my head most of the times, like as a photographer, like what can an image do, right? And I always get that doubts, and it kind of puts me in a position to feel, you know, powerless. Like, do I really have power with photography to be able to change something, especially for the environment that I'm really passionate and really care about? And, but you know, it's actually a cycle, this crying thing. So then you get involved in a community and realize, oh, it's actually making change. You're getting people securing their livelihoods or getting a park protected, and they're so happy. And then you just get rejuvenated, and it's just an endless cycle. So it's really 90% that maybe at night you'll cry like, oh, my work is useless.
Well, I mean, feelings of self-doubt, I know that I have had them myself. I'm sure many of those watching have as well. And by the way, I just want to remind everyone that's watching, if you do have any questions for Gab that you'd like to ask, I obviously have many, but if you have any that you'd like to ask, please just use the Q&A function or the chat function, and I can definitely make sure that one of them gets asked. We actually have one from Gabby Tan that's in the Q&A function right now that I can go ahead and read out. And it's, you know, what are the biggest sources of inspirations to keep you going in the face of challenges during expeditions?
One is that I need to stay alive. I think, like, surviving, you can't change the world if you're dead, to be honest. Like, it's one thing also to just keep inspired and motivated with it. And of course, the biggest source of inspiration, especially with working in a story with people or culture, that I make sure that I really get to represent these stories as justified and as well represented as it is. Because most of the times I think, you know, there's a real big problem in journalism as well, and being able to tell stories that, you know, some people twist or some people find different objectives or harm others because of the stories that they create. And I always make sure to be cautious about it, that I'm sure that I'm really giving justice to the stories that I tell during these expeditions.
And you know, one of the things that you mentioned as being core to stories, a good story, is this idea of conflict. But of course, you know, you also mentioned the importance of kind of telling stories that point people toward solutions and that can inspire people toward kind of, you know, an aspirational reality.
Yeah.
So how do you balance not dwelling on the conflict too much in a way that kind of demotivates or discourages, along the lines of what you were just mentioning?
Yeah, I think that's where you really get to show the communities, you know, not just them being conflicted, but as well rising to these conflicts. It doesn't necessarily have to be a form of resilience. I think resilience can also have could be also problematic because you're not really addressing why they have to be put in that situation in the first place. And I think that's also an important factor to consider. But, you know, the hope that they give the community, these communities, are really what drives, I guess, that understanding of, or being able to show them at their, you know, traditional, or like, in, for example, like the Manobo tribes, their indigenous cultures or their cultures, it's traditions that is so interesting for other people and that they really need to know and take pride in as a Filipino. And that really, in a way, connects them to that kind of beauty in showing, you know, what could be, what the possibilities could be.
Yeah, and I know sometimes, as you mentioned during your presentation, that kind of, you know, telling those stories of conflict and elevating stories that are controversial can sometimes lead to pushback or, you know, even threats, as you mentioned. I guess you mentioned this when we spoke earlier, and I was, I guess, a little surprised to hear about it, but, you know, as, you know, who are you getting threats from? I know you mentioned some of the, these palm oil companies during the presentation, and like, how do you think about that as a storyteller and someone that's trying to your point, make an impact?
Yeah, I think when, for example, that issue with the palm oil plantation, it was the family, this one of the largest multinational palm oil plantations in that region. And the one that was messaging me was actually one of the children of the owner. And it was like, oh, wow, a fellow youth. And I hope I could actually have a discourse with this person and how to bring this story to light. Like, because you have this whole notion of your self. You grew up with palm oil plantations. You think it's really good. And you think you may know the science, or like, does it really? But you don't see the realities that are happening. But sadly, it didn't work out well, because she had this whole idea of her upbringing that these industries are good because it, you know, caters to her family. And how can I change someone's mindset with that, right? And I wanted to engage in a live discussion, but unfortunately it didn't push through. It just became more rampant trolling, then started having text messages. Then I started receiving it from the government, like, to be careful, because I was also working with the government in the ground. And they were like, you have to kind of stay low, because it's not just me who I'm endangering my life. It's also the people who I work with, who I collaborate with, like, who were you with when you took this photo? Or like, they would, you know, maybe investigate. So I really had to be cautious about it.
Yep. Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm glad that you are doing what you need to do to stay safe, though. And I hope that folks decide to engage with the subjects of your stories rather than, actually just physical threats on you. One question in the chat was just around how you first became involved with National Geographic and kind of how you first got on your radar. I know you mentioned a competition earlier. Was that the first involvement or no?
That was like one of the first publications I had, but like in really involvement with like National Geographic Society, becoming an explorer. They have this early career grants that they actually offer to young people, like everyone here, who are doing amazing things for the environment, for culture, for whatever advocacy that you have. I'm not sure if it's open now because of the pandemic.
It is the early career grants are paused, but we will be putting out more information about them soon.
Yeah. So if you have actually an exciting story of your hometown. The one I pitched actually was for the Agusan Marsh, which I just shared, and it got that National Geographic Early Career Grant. And, you know, that really paved the way to being connected with Andrew, being connected with all these amazing explorers around the world.
So we are running into about 5 minutes left here, and I know that the organizers of Youth-A-Thon have put in quite a bit of effort to ensure that we stay on schedule here, so I don't want to mess them up. I guess I do just want to give you the opportunity, Gab, if there's any last pieces of advice that you would share with young people who are watching, and keeping in mind that many of us are just becoming storytellers at the earliest parts of our careers and journeys, and really looking for tangible pieces of, you know, what can we do? And I know you shared so much amazing advice during your presentation, and I hope everyone was taking notes, but anything that you'd want to share just in the final minutes?
Yeah, I think, you know, be as genuine as you can and kind with who you are and how you share your stories. You know, you have so many stories out there for sure, and for those aspiring storytellers, keep making noise. That was one of the National Geographic photographers that I was really, when I first met him, like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm here, you know, sharing that stage with this person, this photographer that I was looking at the images when I was 10, 8 years old in the magazine. And it's like, you know, you got to keep making noise. And that's, you know, stuck in my head. And I realized that you really have to keep making noise in storytelling, and that noise can make sure that it has to be productive in a way. So, you know, find your story in your backyard and, you know, keep inspiring others. I think that's really the most important also, you know, keep your community engaged with the stories that you tell.
I do just want to elevate that last point again, Gab, because I do think it's so important. Every community has a story that can be told, including your own. And like, be sure to tell the stories that are in your own backyard, the ones that are meaningful to you, because that's what you're going to be most effective at conveying. So thank you again, Gab, just for all of this willingness to share behind the scenes, tips and tricks, vulnerability around crying. And so I just really appreciate it and know that everyone watching, I'm sure, is getting a lot out of it.
I agree with you, Andrew. I'm really so amazed with your presentation, and also I felt the synergy between you guys. Like, you're really great. I'm just like chilling and just amazed with your conservation. I'm really so glad that we're having you here today. I think that was so inspiring. And let's not forget that every community has a story.
And I just wanted to step in here too. You guys aren't going to see me on camera because it's late here. But my name is Laura. Gab, it's very nice to meet you virtually. I worked on this event with Andrew last year. Hi, Andrew. It's really good to talk to you again. Thank you guys so much for joining us. It was really, really awesome to have you on the program again this year.
Thank you.